Hello everyone, welcome to Geeta's classes. Today we are going to revise the entire unit of unit 1 of COSM, that is computer oriented statistical methods. Unit 1 we are going to revise, right? So for that I have just incorporated one new technique called mind mapping. First I'll give you a small introduction about mind mapping. A mind mapping is a graphical way to represent ideas and concepts. Instead of writing point by point in a linear fashion, we can write in a different way, graphical way. Okay, so I can say it is a virtual thinking tool that helps structuring our information. Okay, and one more thing, mind mapping, the uses are, mind mapping avoids dull and linear thinking and jogging your creativity and making note taking a fun. Okay, so let us see. I hope this will be useful for you. Now let us go to the unit 1. Unit 1, we have two topics. There are probability, one is probability and another one is random variable. So in probability, we'll see. First we'll see sample space. So what is a sample space? By definition, if you conduct one experiment, what are all the outcomes? If you have more than one outcome, then only we go for probabilistic experiment, right? Sample space is the, generally it is denoted by capital S, and the set of all possible outcomes of statistical experiment is called the sample space. For example, if you toss a coin and then the outcomes are head and tail, therefore capital S is H and T. And if you have, if you throw a die, then the outcomes will be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6, right? So this is our sample space. Then it may be finite or infinite. Finite means we will write like this. And infinite means the notation will be different, set of all x such that x satisfies some condition, depending on the condition. Okay, x greater than or equal to 1, like that. So greater than or equal to 1 means all the other values greater than or equal to 1. This will be like, or it will be, it will be a x is a set of all number of people in a state, in a city, more than 1 million, like that, something. Okay, you can describe, you can describe the value of x here. Okay, so if it is finite, we'll write in the set notation. Infinite means the another set notation of this. Okay, next is complement of the sets. For example, A is equal to, if you throw a die, then A, you define this as an event of getting even numbers. So what is our A? It will be 2, 4, 6, right? So B is equal to, define another event as it, B is an event of getting a number divisible by 3. Then what will be our capital B? It will be 3, 6, right? Therefore, now complement means here S is supposed to be the universal set 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And what is, what will be A bar then, according to this, with respect to S, what is the complement? It should not be in A, it should be in S. Okay, what will be A complement then? 1, 3, 5. Okay, then next is union. Union means either it has to be either in A or in B. So A union B, this means R. Okay, intersection means, so what will be A union B? 2, 3, 4, 6. What will be intersection of A and B? Common element. It should be here. It means it should be divisible by 3 and it should be an even number. So only 6 you will have. Okay. Next is event means what? A subset of sample space. Now, just now we have seen set of all even numbers when you are throwing a die, or prime numbers, like that, any condition which satisfies. But it should be a subset of the sample space. Then trial means experiment with several possible outcomes. We have to repeat this trials. How many times you are repeating the experiment. Okay. Then next is some more definitions of probability. Equally likely events. What is equally likely events? Here we have seen the throwing, when you are throwing a die, S is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. So what is the probability of getting 1? 1 by 6. What is the probability of getting 2? 1 by 6. And so on. There is no reason for all the 6, you have 1 by 6 only is the probability. Okay. So the set of all the outcomes will have equal probability. There will not be any reason to have one event to have more probability or less probability than the others. That is why it is equally likely. All the possible outcomes will have same probability. Then only it is equally likely. Okay. Then next is mutually exclusive events. Mutually exclusive events means occurrence of one will exclude the occurrence of the other. For example, if you are getting tossing a coin, the event of getting a head and event of getting a tail, they are mutually exclusive. When head occurs, tail cannot occur at all. Okay, at a time only one can occur. Okay, then next is independent events. Happening of event is not affected. There is a difference between mutually exclusive and independent events. Independent events, suppose if you have two events A comma B, B does not depend on A or A does not depend on B. Okay. So mutually exclusive means when one is occurring, the other one cannot occur. It excludes the occurrence of the other. Here it is not like that. One depends on the previous experiment or not. Okay. That is independent events, right? They will not be depending on each other. That is, the occurrence of A will not affect the occurrence of B. Occurrence of B will not affect the occurrence of A. Okay. Then we have three different basic definitions of probability. Definitions of probability. There are three main definitions of probability. One is classical probability. What is classical probability? By definition, it is number of basic outcomes that satisfy A by total number of outcomes in the sample space. Okay. So this is by definition, all these definitions are important. You have to by heart these things. Okay. Then similarly, empirical probability, probability of an event is number of times the event A occurs in the repeated trials. Okay. Here we know the outcomes. If you know the outcomes, then what is the probability, like throwing a die and all? That is classical probability. Okay. Empirical probability, when will you use empirical probability? When you are repeating the trials and sometimes, that is previous records, previous history we have. Using that, we are going to define the present, we are going to predict the next things, future things. For example, previous 20 years, what are the temperatures on a particular day? Then, now today's temperature, the prediction of the weather and all. For that, we'll use empirical probability. That is why number of times the event A occurs in the repeated trials divided by total number of trials in the random experiment. How many times they have done, they have entered all these data. Using that, we are going to predict something. In this, we are going to use this empirical probability. Okay. That is proportion of times an event occurs in a large number of trials. One more is, we don't have any idea, just subjective probability. That is an opinion or belief about the chance of occurrence. We don't have anything, any previous data is not available. We don't have any idea about that particular event going to happen. Just the prediction. Okay. Just we are thinking, okay, it may happen like that, it may not happen like that. Suppose if you are launching a new product, then we will assume that this is going to happen, this is not going to happen, something like that. That is called subjective probability. Okay, so three definitions are there for probability. And we have axioms. Axioms of probability. We have first axiom is positiveness, that is P of A greater than or equal to 0. This is first axiom. And what is the second axiom? It is certainty, that is Certainty is P of S is equal to 1. Once again. First axiom is positiveness. Second axiom is certainty. This is certainty. Then what is the third axiom? Suppose if you have A1, A2, etc. An are disjoint events. Then P of A1 union. P of A1 union A2 etc. is equal to probability. Their sum of their separate probabilities. Okay. If you A1 union means what? A1 or A2 or etc. An. If they are disjoint, then it will be equal to P of A1 plus P of A2 etc. This is axiom 3. These are the axioms of probability. Then we have additive theorem of probability. In additive theorem, we have two events and three events. For two events, it is P of A. This is for two events. Okay. P of A union B is equal to P of A plus P of B minus P of A intersection B. Similarly, for three events, A union B union C is equal to. Always remember, here I told you, you have to take always positive and negative. When you are taking one at a time positive, then two at a time negative, and three at a time positive. Okay, so P of A plus P of B plus P of C minus, because we are taking two at a time next. So minus P of A intersection B minus P of B intersection C minus P of A intersection C plus P of A union A intersection B intersection C. This is our additive theorem. Okay, it can be extended for many events also. Next is conditional probability. What is conditional probability? P of A given B. I told you independent events and dependent events. Suppose B depends, B happens first and A depends on B. Okay. So P of, now you can say probability of A given B is equal to, this is the formula you have to remember, probability of A intersection B divided by probability of B. Please remember, after given whatever is there, that will be there in the denominator. Remember like that. And one more condition, probability, the denominator should be greater than 0. Similarly, you can define P of B given A also. Suppose A happens first and B depends on A. Then again, P of A intersection B divided by P of A. Only the denominator will change. That is the conditional probability. And if they are, from this we can derive the multiplicative rules or product rules. Here multiplicative rule, it is also called product rules or product theorem, you can say product rules, you can say. So from P of A given B is equal to P of A intersection B by P of B, we know from this, if you multiply P of B, bring it to the left hand side, P of A given B into P of B is equal to P of A intersection B, this one. Okay, second one. Similarly, from the second one, P of B given A, if you bring P of A to the left hand side, you will get the first result. Okay, these are called the multiplicative rules. And you know, if A and B are independent, if A and B, A does not depend on B, then P probability of A given B, if they are, A and B are independent, this is nothing but P of A only. Okay. If they are independent, then given B will not be there. It will be equal to P of A. So in this case, what will happen? P of A intersection B will be equal to P of B into P of A. Okay. So they are the multiplicative rules. And next comes the important theorem, Bayes theorem. One definite question you can expect from Bayes theorem, conditional probability, multiplicative rules and all. One definite question from Bayes theorem you can expect for 5 marks. Okay. So this is, suppose if you have B1, B2, etc., BK are the events, then probability of BK given A is equal to P of BK intersection A divided by the sum of all the probabilities. Actually, when to use Bayes rule, when you have, suppose BK given A given B1, probability of A given B1, probability of A given B2, and all these things are given and BK given A is asked, or BK given B is B1 given A can be asked, B1 given B2 given A can be asked, like that. That is, you are flipping the probability. When you flip the probability, this is asked, then you have to go for Bayes theorem. Okay. A given B1, A given B2, etc. They are given and you are asked to find out B1 given A, B2 given A, and so on. Okay. So when we do the problems only, you will understand what is this Bayes theorem, right? So with this probability, the first part is over. Next is random variables. What is a random variable? For the outcomes of the sample space, we assign some numbers, numerical value. A real variable x whose value is determined by the outcome of a random experiment is called the random variable. That is, you are having a random experiment and outcomes of the random experiment, we are assigning a real variable. We are defining a function that is called the random variable. And there are two major two parts of random variables. One is discrete and another one is continuous random variables. Okay, two types of random variables. One is discrete and another one is continuous random variable. For discrete random variable, you will have x will take only the discrete values. X can take only discrete values. So like 1, 2, 3, etc. Okay, in between values you cannot define. If you are defining for in between values, it will become continuous, right? And I have given examples for discrete and continuous in our classes. Please go through the videos for that. Okay. So now, how will you find out? Now the formulas you have to remember for discrete and random. Always remember one more differences you have to remember is for discrete means you have to use sigma. Please remember these things also. For discrete it is sigma. Okay. And mu is expectation, mathematical expectation of x. Mu is called the mean of the random variable here. Sigma I varies from 1 to infinity xi pi. For whatever values it is defined accordingly, I is equal to 1 to infinity will vary. Okay. For how many values of x it is defined, like that you have to take the corresponding probabilities. Right. So next is variance of x. Variance of x is the formula is here E of x. And another point I want to inform you here, recollect here, E of x power k, capital X power k, is equal to sigma I varies from 1 to infinity xi power k into pi. Okay. So this is our expectation, mathematical expectation definition is this one. If you have x here, you write xi only. If you have x power k, x squared means it should be x squared here. E of x squared, for example, I'll write one more thing. E of x squared is sigma I varies from 1 to infinity xi squared into pi. Okay. So this is our E of x squared. Variance of x means expectation of x minus E of x the whole squared. Variance is how much it is deviating from the mean. That is what we are going to find out. E of x is nothing but mean. So for each value, how much it is deviating from the mean. Okay. And for that, you have to take the expectation. So expectation of x minus E of x the whole squared. That is equal to E of x. See, whatever is inside, you have to write here. That's what I told. By E of x squared means expectation definition. Or else we have derived one more thing for easier way of calculation. You know that this is E of x squared minus mu squared. E of x the whole squared or mu squared. Okay. This is our variance. Right. Then, and for discrete, we have probability mass function. Probability mass function means what? For x, we are going to assign some pi values. For each xi value, we are going to assign pi values which satisfies these two conditions. Okay. P of xi greater than 0 for all I, and the total probability should be equal to 1. Then we say that it is a probability mass function. Okay. Or PMF. Probability mass function is defined for discrete random variable PMF. Next is for continuous. In random variable itself, we have continuous random variable. In that continuous again, we have to find out mean, variance and probability density function. Here, what is mean? Mu is equal to, I have told you, in discrete, we are going to use sigma. In continuous, we are going to use integration. That is the only difference. All the other formulas are going to be the same. So here u mu is equal to e of x. So minus infinity to plus infinity, x into f of x dx, right? So there we have written x a sigma xi pi. Here integral minus infinity. And this minus infinity to plus infinity, wherever it is defined, the given function is defined, only that interval we have to consider. Okay. Next is variance. Variance again same. A of x squared. Variance of x means by formula it is e of x minus e of x the whole squared. Okay. So variance of x is e of x squared minus e of x the whole squared. So e of x squared is nothing but integral minus infinity to plus infinity x squared into f of x dx minus mu squared. Okay. And in continuous, as we have seen in discrete probability mass function, here it is probability density function. Again, here we are going to define the function f of x, which satisfies, this is nothing but probability only. F of x is defined such that f of x is greater than or equal to 0. First condition, second condition is total probability is 1. Okay. So, and one more thing, one more condition we have added, probability should be well defined because we have to integrate. This integral should exist. That is why the probability, this f of x is nothing but our probability, right? So it should be well defined for any event E. Okay. I think I have covered all the topics. So any problem is given and you have to practice lot of problems. See when to use what problems by seeing the problems what is to be found. Only Bayes' theorem you will get little confusion. Otherwise everything else will be given. See, for example, conditional probability is given. If you are asked to find out, see A happens, B is happening after A. Okay, like that. There will be some clue. What you have to do is read the question carefully once or twice, then to understand the question. Then only you will find out what is asked, right? So, you have to go through the question carefully and depending on that, you should be able to find out what is asked. From that, that will come only by practicing the problem. So you have to use at least minimum every topic minimum 3-4 problems you have to do. Then you will get an idea where to use what. Okay. Thank you so much for listening. I hope this will be very useful for you. The entire unit now you have to practice lot of problems. Okay. Still if you have any doubt you can post it. Thank you so much for listening. Thank you.